On air.
Welcome to Checkpoints. My name is Vivian Kansimi. Now this week we are checking on prisons because there have been reports that there could be a relocation of the Luzira prisons to a different land, and we want to find out what does that mean. Why is there a need to have a relocation of Luzira prisons, and what does that imply when it comes to the logistics of transporting prisoners to courts of law? And also, what is the process of pardoning prisoners? We recently had prisoners who were actually pardoned and they were able to leave Luzira free. How does that process happen? To speak about this is Frank Bene, a senior commissioner of prisons, but also the spokesperson of prisons here in Uganda. You're welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you, dear viewers, and thank you, Vivian, for hosting me. I'm glad to share a few things that happened in Uganda Prison Service. Like you have said, I'm Frank Bene, Senior Commissioner of Prisons and Prison Spokesperson.
How is the prison service, and have you received any reports about this relocation of Luzira prisons?
Well, it's our ritual that we first talk about ourselves. Uganda Prison Service this morning unlocked 76,627 prisoners. These prisoners are in 269 prison units divided into 19 regions. They are being managed by 14,252 staff. And until now, I think the situation is normal. About relocation and what I've been seeing in the media, maybe I need to tell the public that relocation of a prison is not a big thing, because those who know the history of this country, the first prison was at the Port Alice. Port Alice is it is no longer a port because they broke the water from Kituburu. We have a prison called Chitara. That's where the first prison was mounted when courts were in Entebbe, the colonial court. Then from there, they moved that prison to Nabugabo when they called it Kampala Prison. From Nabugabo, they moved it to up where there is Aya Hotel. And it is in 1927 that they moved from this place, the Nakaseru Hill, to Mpanga Hill, which is commonly known as Luzira. So moving of prisons is normal. Mm. But for this case, the facts are that from 2013, there has been a goodwill from government and I think other stakeholders about, if you compare what the prison is for Luzira and a modern facility like a satellite city, like a complex of other activities for modern urban world, which would be a better alternative. So from 2013, different investors, I think, have been approaching the government, and possibilities have been put on the table. But up until now, the discussions actually are at the ministerial level. Even these two documents I saw, which I think was also not right for people to leak, official communication, because it was leaked. I don't think it was a presentation of the PRO or the minister giving his position. When you look at it, it's a leaked document from the president's, from State House to the Minister of Internal Affairs, from Minister of Internal Affairs to the Attorney General. Now, fortunately for us as prisons, or unfortunately for us, the discussion hasn't reached our level. That's why we are not a point of reference. It's at cabinet level. And when the matter is still at cabinet level, these other ones, the common saying is that when the big drum is sounding, the smaller ones have to be silent until such a time. So, but the position is, public policy is what government chooses to do or not to do and the difference it makes. For us as employees of Uganda government, even if we are prisons officers, we must wait until we are involved. And the best that the government thinks for this country is what shall be done.
The best indeed, because even the Parliamentary Committee of Defense is already asking questions about this relocation of the prisons. But first, let's dig into the facts about Luzira, because as we speak now, you have a capacity of about 20,000 inmates, but you have over 75,000. How are you managing that situation of congestion?
That's why I started. I told you that we have 269 prisons. Luzira is a brand for prisons, but not all prisons are in Luzira. Luzira alone has only four prisons. Yes, the main maximum, the 600 they talk about for upper prison, that was for the maximum security prison opened in 1927. Definitely, it would not be possible that up to now, it would still accommodate the same number. Because at the time, Luzira was upper prison was opened as a maximum security prison, the population of Uganda was less than 2 million. Now we are 46 million. So very many things have happened. Now, we have also been trying to construct. It's not that prisons has not been trying to address the problem, but according to the budget and funding levels, we can only expand at a rate of 2% per annum in physical infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
Yet the population of prisoners is increasing at the rate of 8% per annum. And when we are talking about like congestion in prisons, we need to open our eyes. Let's look at the road, our roads. The distance you used to cover in 10 minutes, now you cover it in 2 hours, simply because the vehicles are too many for the road. That means that the Minister of Works is not able to cope with the inflow of developments of locomotives. Let's go to the hospitals. What used to be verandas are now admission areas. What used to be corridors, that's the same thing. So that means that as a country, we need to sit down and look at our economy and look at where to go. Maybe it could even be that if you got a person right now who can set up an establishment under any arrangements that can accommodate maybe 10,000 inmates, maybe 20,000 inmates, it would offset this deficit of accommodation. Recently, actually, as recent as 2020, when COVID was coming in, we opened the facility, the second maximum security prison, Chitaria, with a capacity of 3,000. But that prison got filled in almost 2 weeks. So that tells you that the only way like now we can offset that is to have regional maximum security prisons. But our funding able to cater for that. And rightly so. Yes, our current capacity is actually close to 21% of 21,000 prisoners. But the current number I have given you is 76,000. That means where we are supposed to have one prisoner, we are keeping four. Now, it has a very deep implication because you are supposed to have a separate convicts from remands. When you have such a congestion, you are looking for where to place people. Then you are supposed to say, I know there is a saying where I come from, that if they say the fighters are few, then you say those of gray hair, please get off the fighting line. Then you don't know what you're doing. So that's why a number of things we are supposed to do come under challenge because of the congestion. Some workshops have been turned into accommodation facilities. When you have that congestion, managing the health of people who come from different walks of life becomes a problem. So when you have these diseases which are communicated by closeness, like TB, it becomes a nightmare because it's easy. The congestion allows the spread of diseases. It raises the cost of health. Now, and then you will find that some of these programs then get interfered with. That's why it's a very good and big discussion that we should talk about the prisons.
Let's talk about the amenities that are within the prisons. You have already talked about the health care that is needed. The libraries, because we know that inmates are also part of the candidates that recently UNEB was releasing exams. How did they perform? How are you managing that situation of inmates who are in school and the ones who are sick? Do you have hospitals? Who attends to them? What kind of services do you offer, the different skills that you give to those inmates?
You know, that is very, very important. One of the things, that one comes from what we call the functions of the service. Permit me to read these things because it is very, very important. Form the back. This is the Prisons Act of 2006. It's the current book which we are following. The functions of the Uganda Prison Service shall be to ensure that everybody detained legally in a prison is kept in humane, safe custody, produced in court when required, until lawfully discharged or removed from prison. That is A. B. Facilitate the social rehabilitation and reformation of prisoners through specific training and education programs. C. Facilitate the reintegration of prisoners into their communities. D. To ensure performance by prisoners of work reasonably necessary for the effective management of prisons. And lastly, to perform such other functions as the minister, after consultation with the prisons authority, may from time to time assign the service. So the two major roles we have as prisons or functions is for those who are still undergoing trial to access justice. Then for those who have concluded the trial, to be rehabilitated. Now, what you pulled out as formal education is one of the rehabilitation programs that we run for convicts. And the target is to ensure that these people are realigned, because to come to us, it means they are social deviants. And now we have to realign them. It's like when a car knocks, you take to the garage, it's spanobitten.
Reform.
Mm. So now, in those, the key programs that we have one, what we call formal education, that is from kindergarten up to the university. So it is a deliberate move that going to the prison could be the chance of getting back on track, because some of those are on cases like defilement. You are in senior two, they arrest you, you are going to miss the future. Yes, you have made a mistake, but should the mistake count for the rest of your life? So when you go to the prison, you have another green leaf of reviving your education dreams. Two, most of our people have been involved in crimes or offenses simply because of ignorance. And that's why when we were gauging, when I was doing my master's, I was looking at the effectiveness of rehabilitation programs. And it came out that people who do formal education, 99% don't come back because it changes their perception of life. Actually, 80% of the people we have behind bars are semi-illiterate or totally illiterate. That's why we also introduced another form of rehabilitation called functional adult literacy. It's called FAR, to teach somebody how to read and write. Very important. Then, of course, we have now programs like vocational training. These, you see, we have very beautiful furniture. It is the prisoners who are making. This uniform was made by a prisoner. We have our own tailoring workshops within. Then, fortunately, we to make sure that these people become beneficial, marry into the universal education program. That's why we subject them to the national curriculum and the national exams and standards. The UBTEB, the UNEB, they all come in. Even at tertiary, people do diplomas. In fact, because of this education, the lady who is famous for challenging the death penalty, Susan Chigura, benefited from a law course which she was getting from UK that it opened her eyes, and with the team of 416, they challenged the death penalty, and there have been amendments since then that are very remarkable. So that's why we are looking at that. Now, then there are others, the design, the crafts, the real farming. So all these have come up to help, irrespective of the congestion component about it. And right now we are proud that only 14% of the people who go through our system actually come back. It is one of the lowest rates in the world.
Wow. With all those activities going on in your prisons, or particularly Luzira prisons, how have you managed to improve facilities in terms of the building's expansion to ensure that you are able to accommodate all that?
Of course, we run a budget. Every year we get a budget, and thanks to government, every the other day they are enhancing their budget. The only challenge we still have is that we are now still operating at 45% of what we require. If we go to the funding the way we want, would improve. That's why I told you that me, when I joined the prisons, 1996, they were 49 prisons. Now they are 269 prisons. So you can see the fold in the last 8 years, how much prisons has moved. It's not that we are static, we are moving, but the conditions outside are also racing against us. Now, what is interesting is that every time these institutions that are responsible for justice, the police, the DPP, the courts, the more they improve performance, is the more many people are arrested. And when they are arrested, the end point is the prison. So it is an interesting thing. When the systems improve, still for us it becomes worse. When the institution, the systems slow down, still because we are keeping people, not files, the situation still remains bad for us. Because right now, the numbers I gave you, 40,569 are convicts. That means that's about 53%. 55 are months, but still that doesn't save the situation. The convicts are many, but still the numbers, when you total the numbers, they remain a bit high. So the few things we have been doing is because the little we have had, we are adding on. And that's why for us we pray hard that if the economy can continue appreciating, we shall reach there.
As prisons, have you had development partners who come in to help you with these kinds of situations of congestion and any other needs?
Well, in the previous arrangement, Uganda Prisons was, as an agency, under the Ministry of Internal Affairs, is part of Justice Law and Order Sector. And the Justice Law and Order Sector has what they call the basket fund from the donors. Now we have shifted from Justice Law and Order Sector because the government has changed planning programs. Now we belong to the Access to Justice program. Still, we have the donors. So the money which comes to prisons is not for prisons alone. The donors put money in the basket and it is unilaterally appropriated to the different agencies of government. It is basically in these other like rehabilitation programs where we have some NGOs like MOOBS as a university, as they come to help us for as part of social corporate responsibility to teach our people diplomas in entrepreneurship, small scale business and the like, so that it is their contribution. We have like the Franciscan sisters. With them, they help in the scholastic materials for the formal education and the like. We have the justice defenders. Those ones used to be what they call African Prisoners Project, and they are the ones who connected us to the University of London, the College of Law in London, that is giving, up to now, we have beneficiaries of degrees in law from the University of London. And so that is how we are doing some partnerships.
Okay. So with your current location at Luzira Prisons, where you have all those activities going on, what are some of the advantages that you enjoy by, number one, virtue of you being close to the city? Because you know prisoners are also not supposed to be traveling in the night. What are some of those things that you have enjoyed that have enabled prison service?
Of course, one, behind us is water. So we have a cushion of security. Two, like you have said, our proximity to the town is good. But remember when this prison started, 1927, also moving from Luzira to where the courts were, was very hard, because by the time those vehicles were moving 30 speed per hour. So sometimes it is the dynamism of development. To me, if the infrastructure was to develop well, I visited some European countries. With them, they don't even use vehicles. They use trains. The prisoners at River Trail are taken. They get one of the wagons. It's sealed off. That's where they take the prisoners. They go to court. They come back. In places like Germany, even the staff sleep like in Masaka and work in Kampala. You are only at the station when you're on duty, because it is the efficiency. Actually, what is causing us more problems is a stagnation of very many other things. If all the systems were coordinated and working, some of these things are easy. It's not about where you locate. I saw in the Netherlands, they have a prison on the water. He converted the ship into a prison, and prisoners are there. So the location for now, because of the circumstances, you may think it's favorable. But still, if we are looking at improving the economy, you have to compare. If I left the prison here, or if I brought a development project that would earn 100 times more than the prison, should the location become the matter? That is the question we have to debate. So what is better? Yes, like I told you, at one time, the prison was located at Nakasero Hill. But the wise men of the time thought that Nakasero Hill was not a place for the prisoners. They thought they looked for the most distant place away. That's how they created the Ruzira. Now Ruzira has become so near. So I think through the wise or the wisdom which is existing, that's why those who see far, they say, okay, don't you think this place, the location, is more ideal for other developments that would generate money to sustain prisons better than wanting to hang onto a facility? I will give you an example. I started my prison work in Ichigo. Where you see Mirembe Villas, that's where we used to grow cassava and soya bean. But now when you look at the development in that area, genuinely, would you think that the decision for letting this land go back to the Kabaka and use it for another development was wrong? I don't think so. Because that place already is housing about two hotels. It has a complex of apartments. It's a business hub now. So that's why we need to, if we have to live an open-minded, we shouldn't say, as it was, is, and ever it shall be. The dynamism is that we must open up to what is going on. When I grew up seeing the Clock Tower standing and around about. You go there now. When you look at these flyovers that they have put, somebody will cry and say, hey, why did they remove the Queen's Clock? But, I mean, shouldn't the development take place because of something which was put? So I think if it is in good faith, if it is for the right reasons, location shouldn't be an issue when we are discussing where prisoners can come from or where can be kept.
Well, we are going for a short break. We will be right back. And we'll be talking about pardoning of prisoners. Well, thank you for keeping it urban. We are with the Senior Commissioner of Prisons, who is also the prison spokesperson, Frank Bainey. He is talking to us about how they will be relocating the prisons if government makes that decision. There have been reports of government plans to have Luzira prisons relocated to another spacious area, but we're also talking about a range of issues, an in-depth analysis of what goes on in the prisons and what is happening with the different activities that take place to reform prisoners. Frank, let's talk about land utilization with prisons, because we know that these prisons are located on very huge chunks of land,
especially the prison farms.
Yes. And yet you only occupy bits of it. In Luzira here, you have been neighboring an industrial area. But now part of your land has become an industrial area. Talk to us about that.
Well, in the actual sense, the only industries in Luzira were used to be Port Bell. The whole of this hill used to belong to prisons. But prisons is a sitting tenant. All land in Uganda for government belongs to the land commission. And in one of those land acts, it is clearly states that the Uganda Land Commission is at liberty to change the land use, even without consulting the sitting tenant. As the dynamism of industrialization were coming up, government made a decision that some of these industries can be put to coexist with Uganda Prison Service. Mm. And that's why we have Kampala Quality Chemical Industry, one of the best in East and Central Africa, sitting. Where it is sitting, it is prison's land. Now, there is a host of other industries. So what I'm trying to explain is that over time, government decides what this land can be used. We used to have giant farms like Mubuku. At one time, Mubuku was 7,000 acres of land, all for prisons. But when the transformation of agriculture was coming in, I think in the 70s, and the idea of irrigation scheme came up, and one Mubuku River was one of those identified to have consistent flow of water. Two-thirds of Mubuku prison land was allocated to Mubuku irrigation scheme. And the production was good, and it was because government was being dynamic in land use. Actually, then around late 90s, no, I think it was already 2000, because of the population pressure in the area, the 2,000 acres of land had remained for prison, but the Basongola had nowhere to stay. So a decision was made by government. They removed 1,500 acres and gave it to the Basongola to resettle them. And now Mubuku prison farm has 500 acres. So over time, like I say, prisons is an agency of government. Even if we are seated on land, this land belongs to government. And the government at any one time can change the land use. These days, of course, we are proud that we reactivated the commercial farming. We are able to feed ourselves for about 7 months using our own crop. We got presidential directives that when there was a problem about 5 years back, when there was a problem of seeds, people were fabricating seeds and the production of maize had gone down. Right now, close to 50% of the maize seed on the market comes from prisons. That's why it does not surprise that now the production has gone high and the prices are beginning to do what? To develop. But at least the production and the productivity is being seen through what we have done. When the president wanted to revive the cotton, the textile industry, because people had run away from these intensive crops like cotton, he gave us a directive. Right now, about 35% of the cotton that is being used for the textile industry comes from prisons. So the beauty about it, that's why you see in the functions of the prisons, the last one says that any other duty assigned by the minister in consultation with the prisons, what? Authority. And that's why, like, these discussions, the minister will discuss what it will be concluded as cabinet. Then, for us, we shall be involved at the implementation level. That's the beauty about it. So, but then, in 2006, we took over 174 prison units from the former local government prisons. All those prisons were sitting on Kabaka's land, or Uganda land, what they famously called Maira Kenda. Now, we have been in contention and negotiation with Uganda to ensure that we coexist. You know, in the act, they said we are supposed to take on the liabilities and assets of the local government prisons. But in the actual sense, when the takeover came, the local government were like, take your prisoners. the land remains ours. So they gave us liabilities and they insisted to keep the what? The assets. Now, and that's why it's once in a while there is an eruption of who owns this land, who wants the other land. But for us, we use one standard aspect that we negotiate and explain that we are using the land, we own the land, but we know land has the owners. Either it is government or it is the kingdom, as long as we can coexist.
Well,
and then in a few instances, we have been made to buy prison land and relocate. The recent one is in Tungamo. We used to be in Tungamo town because it was too small and the population was increasing. We have now bought land about 10 kilometers away and we have put up a facility. At least now we think we can expand to how we want it.
Well, let's talk the pardoning system. In accessing justice, we also know that some prisoners get pardoned.
Mm-hmm.
What is the process of being pardoned?
Before I go into that, I need to inform the viewers. In this constitution of 1995, Article 121 talks about prerogative of mercy. And in this prerogative of mercy, they say, there shall be an advisory committee on the prerogative of mercy, which shall consist of, one, the attorney general, who shall be the chairperson, and B, six prominent citizens of Uganda appointed by the president. The most important part is on section 4, which says the president may, on the advice of the committee, grant any person convicted of an offense a pardon, either free or subject to the lawful conditions. B, grant a person a respite, either indefinite or for a specified period, from the execution of punishment imposed on him or her for an offense. C, substitute a less severe form of punishment for a punishment imposed on a person for an offense, or remit the whole or part of the punishment imposed on a person, or the penalty or forfeiture otherwise due to government on account of any offense.
Hmm.
Then finally they say, where a person is sentenced to death of an offense, a written report in the case, that is now the detail. Now, in our constitution, they said, yes, the justice system is clear. The courts can do their part. But a president, as a fountain of honor, for his own reason, it could be compassion, or no, any other mitigating factors, could decide that some people are forgiven. But if not, he could decide that those people are hanged. It's a double-edged sword. So that's how the prerogative of mercy comes in, that the prerogative of mercy rests with the fountain of honor. Now, how do you get the pardon? To get to the pardon, a pardon is strictly given to a convicted prisoner. A remand cannot be given a pardon because you cannot forgive if you have not proven that somebody has done wrong. So a convicted prisoner from one day to death sentence, there are conditions which make them qualify. And because of this, every year, Uganda Prison Service submits a list of those people who fall in that category of pardon to the Attorney General and his team to decide. Sometimes they work on it, sometimes they don't work on it. But the president, they say, may. Sometimes he may decide to pick a person outside the lists that have been what? Submitted. And he pardons. Now, but what are the standard conditions? The standard conditions are that all prisoners that have been sentenced to death and have completed the appeal process. Because when you are sentenced by the High Court and you lose the case, you must appeal in Court of Appeal. If Court of Appeal agrees with the High Court, you still must appeal in the Supreme Court. So if the the Supreme Court is the highest apparent court. If the Supreme Court agrees with the subordinate courts that you should be hanged, then you are remaining with one chance for the president to say, I have forgiven you. That is what we call the so all prisoners on death row that have finished their appeal process appear on that list. But one of the things that prisoners must put is remorsefulness and discipline of the prisoner. That is one of the requirements we have to justify. If a prisoner is not disciplined, if the prisoner is not remorseful, you indicate. And that has an impact on whether this person qualifies for pardon or not. Two, all capital offenders. Capital offenders are those who commit offenses that are triable by the High Court. In the real English, they call them felonies. Those who commit felonies, according to the penal code. All those who are remaining with 6 months of their sentence, they qualify. Then, we have the major people who are in this, are especially on the minor offenses, misdemeanors. Those who have finished 50% of their sentence, because these are normally small sentences, 2 years, 1 year, those who have finished 50%, they fall in. Then there are special categories in this. We have the suckling mothers or pregnant women are a category. Then we have the terminally sick. Then we have the elderly above 65. So those are the categories we submit. But there is another line that a person who is in prison can use his lawyers to petition the president. Then the president will ask the attorney general to ask prisons to write a profile and report back to the attorney general whether that person actually qualifies. Then the president will make a decision. And that's why sometimes it's the president can finish here without pardoning. He can pardon maybe 2 or 3 people, depending on what he wants to do. It's the discretion of the president.
So recently we saw a number of people who were pardoned.
Yeah. 13.
Yes.
Yeah.
Were there any breastfeeding mothers or terminally?
Well, according to, because for us we had submitted 200 and there were about 285 names submitted. And they picked 13. The criteria they used, me and you can't know, because that is now the work of the attorney general. He is the one who knows how they selected the ones they selected. But for us, we had submitted a big number, those who we thought were qualifying in the circumstances. But some time back, if you remember, they pardoned about 200 just for the congestion. But this one, they were talking of health and compassionate grounds. So
you're saying health and compassionate grounds. How many of those had those health conditions that you're talking about?
Well, I don't have the figure off cuff. That's why I'm saying the discretion. For us, we write as is. If Baine has a terminal illness, you indicate it as part of the report. Now, when those people reach there, they decide whether they want to consider all of them. They decide what is remaining. You see, what is remaining part of the sentence also matters. Mm. You can't believe that even at the time these orders came, some of those people had already even been released. But that one doesn't change anything about the pardon. It means that the goodwill of the president to pardon was there.
Then, as a jailer, what do you think, because you said most of your prisoners are either semi-literate or illiterate.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think are some of those things that this category of people can do to avoid jailing?
Information. Information. Because you see, ignorance is the biggest enemy to anybody. I want to tell you, it is ignorance, because when you gauge what we have, aggravated defilement and minor defilement, maybe to explain a bit, minor defilement is where the girl is 14 years and above. And the defiler is also within range, is not beyond 20 years. And then it was consensual sex, and there were no diseases or pregnancy involved. That's minor defilement. But any sexual act on a girl 14 below, that one is aggravated. Now, but what I'm trying to explain is that when you get the two offenses, there are many in the penal code, but when we combine aggravated and minor defilement, it constitutes 60% of the total population of prisoners. And that one is largely because of the ignorance.
It is the highest.
Because in some regions, it is normal to marry girls of 13. It's normal to marry girls of 16.
Culturally?
Culturally. Now, but the law does not allow anybody to get married below 18. And unfortunately, when the information leaks, it is now no longer up to the parents. It's up to government. That's why it is Uganda versus Baini. So, education, that's why we came up with functional adult literacy. That's why most of the programs are about educating. It is about ignorance and laziness that causes most of these crimes. And that's why when you are with us, we make sure you appreciate work. We make sure you learn. And managing, counseling is one of the biggest way, because especially the majority of women, they are involved in crimes of passion. Just emotional imbalance. They don't want to manage their emotions. Not that they don't want, but they don't know how to manage their emotions. And then they find themselves behind the what? Behind the bar. So, and that's why we emphasize, at least taking these people through religious empowerment, through counseling, through strict discipline, then over time, so that when they go back to society, they would have seen another life, that the things they didn't want to do willingly, they have done them under confinement. And it is possible that when they come out, the new trend continues than wanting to go to where they were coming from before they entered prison.
Your parting shot.
Well, my parting shot is that we need to know that if we are going to gauge the performance of a country, you don't look at the high end. Like Mandela said, the prison is one of the best gauges to capture. And that's why you see when people like are saying, this university education, when I tell you that 70% of the people in prison are illiterate, that tells you where this country is going. Mm. So we need to focus on our prisons. We need to understand that these people in prison, actually our sisters, our fathers, our relatives and friends, and 99.9% of the people who come to prison actually go back to what? Society. So when they are even behind bars, don't forget them. Don't mar off their wives. Don't sell off their property. Let's keep supporting them. A prison is like a hospital. If you take a patient to hospital and they give you injections, then when they say take this person home, you starve this person, the person will die, even if he has gotten the right what? Treatment. So reintegration requires the community. I always say this. As prisoners, I know we have a lot of congestion, and maybe it is increasing. We do not invite anybody to come as a prisoner, but we are ready to welcome whoever comes as a prisoner. So it's your choice to avoid crossing the line. If you cross the line, we always have space for you.
Well, Frank Baini, spokesperson of prisons and senior commissioner of prisons, we are very glad that you have spoken to the checkpoint. But for you out there, always think twice before you cross the line, because the prisons will be waiting for you. Until next week, I'm Vivian Kamsimi on the checkpoint.